Whereas offences against property have of late increased in and near the metropolis, and the local establishments of nightly watch and nightly police having been found inadequate to the prevention and detection of crime, and whereas it is expedient to substitute a new and more efficient system of police in lieu of such
Peeler,
establishments...
Peeler, by Patrick Carroll.
...and nightly police within the...
Episode 1.
...and to constitute an office of police...
Oh, Mr. Peel, what have you done? Your police act so grand, sir. It will be the cause, I have no doubt, of filling Van Diemen's land, sir. London now, believe me, sir, is overstocked with queer cones who wish the police act and you were sent to Jimmy Squaretoes.
Constables will parade for inspection.
We have our usual complement of new faces this morning, Sergeant.
So we do have, Inspector. I've become quite accustomed to it.
You'll observe that the orders of the day instruct us to second at one sergeant's party for duty at Westminster tomorrow. I would prefer it to be yours.
Yes, sir.
Stand for inspection.
Before this morning's inspection, I'm instructed to read out and post the following notice. The commissioners think it again right to caution every man in the police force at a time when an attempt is made to create a strong prejudice against them that they should do their duty with every possible moderation and forbearance, and that they should not furnish a just ground of complaint against themselves by any misconduct. Right, you may continue, Sergeant.
Sure. The party of constables under my command will tomorrow repair to Westminster. Large crowds are expected, and the commissioners anticipate a possible threat to the public order. Constable Atkinson.
Sergeant.
You will resume your usual beat today, and I wish you to pay particular heed to those coming and going from the Gunmaker's Arms in Air Street Hill.
Yes, Sergeant. I shall make sure to look in there.
You will do no such thing. You ought by this time to know your instructions sufficiently well to be aware that you are forbidden to enter any house, and most especially a public house, save at the express wish of the householder.
Sergeant.
You'll also replace the button which your greatcoat wants before commencing duty.
Yes, Sergeant.
Constable Smith, usual duties for you. Smith, step out.
Sir?
You are drunk, Constable.
No, sir.
Do not presume to contradict me, Constable. It's not yet 7 o'clock in the morning and you are drunk.
I'm not, sir. It's only this miserable, cold, damp weather's clogged my head so and turned my eyes all red.
A quartern of Geneva or a gallon of port has put the maps in your eyes, or I'm much mistaken.
No, upon my soul, Sergeant, I've not had one drop of anything this week past. Well, only one glass of hot rum last night to ease the ague.
Step back, Constable.
Sir.
Take warning. You are under the strictest observation. Mind my words. Constable Rourke, it's but your second day of duty, and yet you appear to have contracted some dreadful palsy. Keep your head still.
With respect, Sergeant, it's this stock. It's so very iron stiff, a man can't hardly move his head from side to side.
You must address your complaint to the commissioners, or else to the maker, Mr. Moore of Piccadilly, I believe.
Sergeant.
For the present, however, I shall be quite satisfied if you'll proceed to your beat, keeping your eyes strictly to the front, and endeavour to do your duty by whatever comes to your attention in that posture.
Yes, Sergeant.
Constable Quinn, you appear to be respectably turned out as usual.
I trust I am, Sergeant.
Excepting in one particular. What have you in your coat-tail pocket, pray?
My staff, sir.
That's not all, I think.
I have a book as well.
A book, indeed. And what book is that? Your general instructions?
No, sir, it's this book.
This book? The works of Henry Fielding, Esquire. With an essay on his life and genius by Arthur Murphy, Esquire. Much any man named Murphy would know a genius. Follow your mate. Containing the first part of the history of Amelia. Do you find the possession of novels an indispensable adjunct to the performance of your duties, Quinn?
No, Sergeant. However, with respect, as we are required to be in uniform at all times, on duty and off, I find it convenient to have a volume about me for when I am relieved.
You will leave such rubbish in your section house in future.
Yes, sir.
Do you know why we are ordered to Westminster tomorrow, Constable?
For the opening of Parliament, I assume, sir.
Oh, you assume that, do you? Parliament has contrived to open in the past without several score of police to keep order. Now, of course, we must endure the low popish scoundrel O'Connell and Mr. Orator Hunt and the rest of the Democratic Reformist rabble. You, I'm told, hold your own views on the question of parliamentary reform.
I do, sir.
And what are they, pray? Or are you ashamed to state them?
I am not, sir. Since you inquire, I am in favour of a moderate reform of the representation.
Moderate reform? As well speak of moderate gunpowder. Yeah. I'm sure your brother officers will be gratified to know that you are in a measure of sympathy with the mob who well may be attempting to break their heads before tomorrow is out.
My brother officers know that I am in no sympathy whatever with anyone who threatens the public peace.
Though you share their opinions.
I shall do my duty as usual, sir.
Mercenary? Damnable? Vile wretches? Peel's bloodthirsty gang. From them, we can expect no mercy, for their nature, like that of their founder, is base, blood-seeking, and villainous. Well, well.
And that's a relatively mild example of what's being presently circulated against our people.
It cannot be said that this past summer's revolutionary events on the continent have made our tasks any easier.
Yes, those regrettable upheavals have excited a large and, I fear, ill-disposed section of the populace. And the new police are of their nature, our first line of defence against any consequent disturbances. It is a difficult baptism, gentlemen, for you and your men.
We can none of us do anything but our duty, Sir Robert.
Returning to those duties, Sir Robert, are we to take it that you are satisfied with the arrangements made for tomorrow?
Entirely so, Mr. Mayne. Studying over your report, I fail to see what further precautions could possibly be taken, short of cancelling the opening of Parliament altogether, a course which, naturally, could not be contemplated under any circumstances whatever.
Excellent. Then we shall take up no more of the Home Secretary's time, but proceed to put our plans into effect.
Perhaps, before you go, gentlemen, you will allow me to acquaint you with this passage contained in a letter which I have lately received from His Grace the Duke of Wellington. Permit me to congratulate you on the complete success of the police in London. It is impossible to see anything more respectable than they are.
Having been privileged to serve under His Grace during the war against Bonaparte, I'm gratified to be assured that our men enjoy his good opinion.
You may depend upon it, Colonel Byrne. Having informed the Duke that the business has given me from first to last more trouble than anything I ever undertook, I also conveyed my personal opinion that his congratulations might with equal justice be directed towards your two selves.
Yet I fear the success of the police in London is not so complete as the Prime Minister is pleased to believe. Leaving aside the criminal element and the political mob, large sections of the populace remain obdurately opposed to our very existence.
That is in a measure true, Mr. Mayne. But, as I've also said to the Prime Minister, the men are gaining knowledge of their duties so rapidly that I am very sanguine of the ultimate result. We really must teach people that liberty does not consist in having your house robbed by organized gangs of thieves, and in leaving the principal streets of London in the nightly possession of drunken women and vagabonds.
Sir, that gentleman does not want your banner thrust into his carriage window. I am telling you, sir, that do not use that flag, so I must take it from you.
Look out! My dear sir!
To the Reverend Mr. Hodgson, St. George's, Hanover Square. Sir, I am desired by the Commissioners of Police to acquaint you that John Hall, recommended by you for employment in the police force, has absconded with his uniform and all his appointments, yours, etc.
Yes, that'll do, Mr. Yardley.
What do you make of this, Colonel? I've been through these others, Mr. Yardley. The four applications from dismissed constables for reinstatement may be dealt with by Form 7, and I've docketed two further letters requiring Form 9, two Form 4s, and six to be answered by a new Form 2. I do not believe we have a form answer for such a letter as that one, Colonel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.